Coming up next on Gardener's Hotline, we'll be talking about Florida strawberries. Stay tuned.
From the studios on the Daytona State College East Campus.
Welcome back to another edition of Gardener's Hotline. I'm your host, Karen Stotterman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension agent. The most challenging fruit to grow in Florida, the Florida garden, is strawberries. So many people are confused as to when to plant them and when to harvest them. Here in Florida, they are known as winter berries. Commercially, they are planted in October and harvested from Thanksgiving to Easter. In most years, the season will last until early April, depending upon the temperatures and its environment. They are annuals in Florida. This means they are destroyed yearly after each season. It's not that they don't survive the summer, it's just that the temperatures and the pests play havoc on the plants, and the yields are significantly reduced in the following year. Meet Ted Campbell, the executive director of the Florida Strawberry Growers Association. Welcome to the show, Ted.
Well, thank you, Karen. Glad to be here.
Ah, Ted, how did you get into strawberries?
Well, I was a retailer all my life, and it's such a popular item, it really drove me to try and help the producers a little bit.
Well, that's our wonderful success that he's been here. But before we get started, I'd like to invite all you viewers at home to call into today's program by dialing this number, 1-800-901-9238. All right, Ted, tell me how important strawberries are to the state of Florida.
Well, it has a huge economic impact, obviously. The strawberry crop value is about $400 million.
Wow.
And that really translates into an economic impact of over $800 to $900 million. It's bigger than three Super Bowls a year.
Wow, I'll say so. How many people does it employ?
Well, we're collateral, it's about 60,000 people. Between
60,
direct employment on the farm and up and downstream from the farm.
How many acres is found in Florida?
Over in Hillsborough, eastern Hillsborough County has over 10,000 acres now. So it's a very substantial crop. It's 40% of Hillsborough County's ag value.
Tell me a little bit about the U-pick operations. How widespread are they throughout
Florida?
Well,
you find U-picks really at the end of the season and smaller boutique growers that do U-pick throughout the year. But in the commercial fields, they generally don't let the public in until it's over for commercial value. And then many of them open up, and some have charitable events. We have a 4-H pick for fundraisers and things like that. So it's really been fun at the end of the season.
Are the years where there's freezing weather good or bad for strawberries?
Well, strawberries don't like to be wet, and when you freeze, you have to irrigate for protection. So, freeze is never good. Cool weather, however, gives them really great flavor. When they slow the maturity down, they get really, really sweet. So we like cool nights, but not freeze.
I see. Well, tell me a little bit about how the commercial production is started. How do growers get started preparing their fields?
Well, they start usually in September or late August and level the fields out, put in fumigant, raise the beds, put in the plastic, lay all the infrastructure in place.
This is where they're making beds here?
This is a bedding machine. Now the bedding elevates the product. You put the drip line right in there. It helps the growers and the pickers because it elevates it. The black plastic keeps it nice and warm in the wintertime, helps the roots. The guys riding on the back there make sure that it feeds off correctly, and the drip line irrigation tubes go in at the same time. Now after that bedding process, this is punching the holes, which spaces the plants out. There's about 20,000 plants per acre planted. They're done by hand. And there you can see the hand planting. They generally take bare root plants, use their thumbs, stick it through each hole, and everything is hand done. Hand planted, hand weeded, hand trimmed, hand picked. It's a very, very labor intensive crop.
Now, the black plastic also speeds up the ripening as well as keeps weeds down, right?
It keeps the weeds under control. It warms the bed, warms the soil, protects them so they grow a little quicker. It keeps some of the dirt off, and it adds for drainage. If you have a rain or something, that the water drains off very quickly. And as I said before, the fruit really wants to be dry.
Right, and pick it up off the ground.
Keep it up off the ground.
All right. Now, when they pick the berries, let's go into the harvesting section. I know they have two different kinds of flats. We have the regular field or agricultural flats you see here. We've got two types. We've got the one type with these green baskets. They must have had these for years.
This has been around forever. This is the dry pint, we call it.
Truly a pint.
Pints and quarts. This is one U.S. pint, not a liquid pint, a dry measure pint. So it's a dry product, and it's a volume measurement rather than a liquid measurement.
Now we have these new ones.
Okay. Now the industry has pretty much converted into the plastic clamshell.
Now why?
And it has brought a lot of advantages. Now this is field packed. All these are field packed. As the picker goes, they put the place it right in that package.
Just like this flat up here up front.
Exactly. And it's packed in the field to you. It's never touched again once that lid goes closed. But the plastic allows good air circulation. It has allowed them to cool quicker and more efficiently. It gives you good visibility. It's stackable at retail so that you can see what's in that container. It contains the humidity, so you get a little extra shelf life. They don't dehydrate very quickly. It's safe and sanitary. You don't have people handling through all the loose fruit the way it used to be done years ago. And they're stackable at retail. You can put a label on it, so you can add value. You can put a coupon on it. You can put, we have QR codes on some of the packages now that you can scan with your smartphone, and it'll lead you right back to the website of the grower.
Wow.
And tell you who picked it, and show you a picture of the farm, give you nutritional value. There's all kinds of value-added things that are now being placed on the consumer container.
So does it tell you the date it was picked as well, the freshness
date? You can't look it up, but the grower can. So as he gets feedback, he can say, well, you know, that was 3 weeks old. If a person complains and says, your berries were horrible, he can look on the coding and say, well, gee, it was 3 weeks old. Something went wrong in the system somehow. So, but yeah, we love having the consumer feedback and having that ability to relate to the farmer, put a face on the farm.
I see. Well, Ted, we've got a caller on the line, Cindy from Daytona. Hi, Cindy. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Ted?
Well, my question basically is, I live beachside Daytona Beach, and I grow strawberries. It's in large pots. My concern is, over the winter, it seems as though it's dying out. You don't see any of the leaves or anything, and then it comes back. It looks great, but I'm not sure if I'm planting on the right side, the north side, or should I be on the southeast side, or I'm not really sure.
She has a question about her strawberries in Daytona. She's on the beach side.
Okay.
And she wants to know if it makes a difference whether or not she should plant it on the north, the east, the south, or west, because they were down in the winter, but they flushed back out again. What do you recommend people who live on beach side?
Well, you have salty air. It's hard on the plants no matter what. So, you're in a challenging location if you're near the beach. These plants do not like salt in any way.
So now, Ted, what about container planting? She can do that?
You could do containers. That works. You can protect them better that way. That's a good suggestion, Karen.
Yeah, but no matter what, the salt spray is, there's no friend of strawberries.
Salt spray is not a friend of many plants.
I'll think not. Okay, so we've talked a little bit about these full-size flats. As you can see, we have them here in the clamshells and then here with the green baskets. They hold the same weight.
Right.
Okay, so 10 pounds each. This is a true agricultural flat.
It is a 10-pound flat either way. And
we've seen them in stores where they're half flats.
Well, some of the larger box stores like to sell in larger increments. So you'll see 4 and 2 pound clamshells. They make this in a 2, a 4 pound. There's various ways of doing it. But you're trying to raise the incremental sale. If a customer buys more, they eat more. If you have it in your refrigerator, you're more likely to eat it. So that's really the objective.
Not to mention all the health benefits.
They are remarkably healthy. They are huge with vitamin C, great antioxidant value, many, many, many effects. And we're seeing now some really neat scientific research showing the effects of multiple berry usage. When you mix your berries, when you have strawberries, blueberries, blackberries, raspberries together, there are huge, even better medical benefits and nutritional benefits than berries alone.
That's wonderful. What a great place to live in Florida. We have all these great fruits in the middle of winter.
We are very fortunate. We have a winter climate that produces these things.
Now, Ted, you're going to have to explain our guest here today.
Well, we've got the jammer here, which has been our character. What we started doing was looking at teaching children all of the attributes of strawberries. And as we did that, we needed a cartoon vehicle to keep their attention. They don't like just somebody standing there telling them facts. So we created a cartoon, and we made the jammer character to say all about strawberries, how many seeds, how they're planted, how they grow, how they're planted. We show the bedding machines and tractors. The kids love that. So jammer became a marketing tool when the adults actually loved what we had created for the children. So it has served a purpose of marketing to everyone.
So every time we see the little jammer character, that means it's fresh from Florida.
We are actually putting labels up in the stores on the packages in many cases saying Florida grown with jammer. So we're trying to create a vehicle where if you can look for jammer on the package, the picture, you'll know it's Florida grown product.
Where can teachers get more information about jammer? I see you have a cute little coloring book there.
On our website, we have a site for teacher materials. We have created a jammer coloring book. And in it, it has all the attributes and facts about strawberries, how much vitamin C you get, how they're picked, how they grow, how they developed. So it's available from our website.
And we'll put the website up at the end of the show.
Right. It's on now on the screen. So
right.
You can see our website.
FLAstrawberry.com.
Right.
Wonderful. Well, we've got another caller on the line, Ted. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question today?
Yes, how are you? I would like to know, I am calling from Poinciana, Florida. I would like to know why the strawberries are not as sweet as they used to be.
Okay, he's wondering why they're not as sweet as they used to be.
Every year is different, and it has to do with the climate. Obviously, this year has been quite warm. If you live in Florida, you know what it's been. Warm accelerates growth. So the strawberries are maturing faster than they normally would with nice cool nights, which is what really gives you flavor. And the reason they develop a better flavor is the extended maturity of the cool nights. They stay on the plant for a while longer. This year it's been really hot, so the plants have accelerated and they don't always have the flavor, but it's there, they'll come back.
How cold is the right temperature?
Well, we love 40s at night.
Okay.
60s is okay. No freezing.
Right.
You know, we're trying to avoid the freeze situations, obviously. But, you know, cool nights really, really are very favorable for the strawberries. And typically here in Florida, we're 70s in the days and 50s at night, which is really ideal.
Now, we pick for such long periods of time, and I know growers have different varieties in their field. But how many times do you know that a grower will pick that same plant?
The plant will be picked every 3 days, just about. That's the cycle of rotation for picking. They are ever-blooming. They will put out a large flush of fruit at one time and then rest a bit, but they will continuously bloom and make fruit throughout the entire season. So you have to maintain a regimen of picking every 3 days. It's the equivalent of picking 400,000 plants a week for us in Hillsborough County. It's a big, big deal, requires a lot of hand labor.
From picking in the field, how fast can it get to the grocery store?
Well, we have local grocery stores can get them the same day, actually. One of the big packers there has a grocery store chain, drops their trucks. Several of them will put their trucks right at the cooler. They'll be picking fruit in the field in the morning. As soon as it's chilled and refrigerated, it can go on board that truck and right to their distribution center and out to the stores that day. A little further distance shipping. In 1 day's radius shipping, we can ship to Atlanta, Charlotte, North Carolina, overnight. A second day delivery would be New York and Boston and some of those areas where we would be second day arrival. Third day from harvest, we're in Canada, all the way up into Montreal and even into Nova Scotia.
Wow.
On a 3 day, or Chicago. So, you know, when you look at a 3 day shipping radius from, which is pretty fresh, we've got half of the United States covered and,
wow.
and a lot of the population of Canada.
Wow. Now, why don't we talk about how to pick a strawberry? I want to point out that we want to make sure it's red from bottom to top.
Right.
Okay.
Good
and
color.
When they take the strawberry, do you
Good
give
color.
It a little twist?
Well, the secret of picking a strawberry is, pick a ripe one, and you just kind of rotate it on the stem. You just roll it and it comes right off very cleanly. No bruising. Don't squeeze it. Don't push it.
And don't pull it.
And don't pull it. If you pull, it's a funny thing with strawberries. If you pull them, the vine will not give.
Right.
But if you roll it like this, it just snaps off effortlessly.
Now, the flat up front, I like to always describe that, or I always like to pick mine with a little bit of stem on top. Not only does it keep it fresh, but it gives your finger something to hold on to if you decide to chocolate dip it.
It does.
Or if you decide to dip it in cream or something.
Makes it easier to eat.
Easier. You have to use your thumbnail at that, but they're a little more delicate that
right.
way.
You can pinch the stem off, or you can roll it off, snap it off.
So what do you think about the future of strawberries? Where are we going?
Oh, it's only going up. The strawberries are so popular. They're right up there with chocolate. You know, 96% of the public loves strawberries. And you've got a popular item that's very healthy for you. So it's the best of all worlds. You're eating something that people enjoy and is very good for them. So, you know, it is nothing but up. This has been one of the growth categories in produce that has maintained growth throughout the economic struggles that we've had in the last couple of years. The berry category has continued to rise. So, you know, we're seeing, again, insurgence from blueberries and other varieties. They're available year-round now. There's a lot of attributes, and people just like eating strawberries. So it's going to be a very good business.
Now, tell me about the Strawberry Festival. Each year, how long have we been doing the Strawberry Festival?
Oh, festival has been going on for over 70 years now, and it's very, very popular. It's amazing. It comes right on the heels of the State Fair, and both of these events draw upward almost a million people now within a couple weeks of each other. But the festival has rides and entertainment. It has a lot of big name entertainment, singers, country music, popular music. It has a lot of free entertainment within the grounds where you can go see shows daily. Just been a lot of fun. It's a very family atmosphere. They don't serve alcohol and things like that. So you have a clean family environment where you can come out and have a lot of fun, eat some really good food. Everything's fried. real health food there. And really see some big name entertainment. So it's been a really popular thing to celebrate our crop.
How many tourists comes each year?
Oh, it's in the over a half a million.
Wow, that's quite a bit.
It's very, very popular. It runs for 11 days, usually in early March. And just very, very...
Is there anything that the children do? We used to have, strawberry days? Tell me a little bit about
what happens. Kitty rides. They have various events. There's obviously agriculture where the 4-H and FFA kids show their animals. They have a kitty ride area for smaller rides, and then they have the big adult whiz-bang rides.
Any time off?
They have a day off from school every year. Usually the first Monday of the festival is schools out in eastern Hillsborough County, and they have a grand parade, and everybody turns out. It moves throughout the whole city of Plant City. But they have stemming contests for kids. They have a baby contest. They have decorated diaper contests. You know, there's a lot of things that are fun for the community. And really, that's what festival is about. It's a fun time.
And we are the winter strawberry capital of the world.
The winter strawberry capital of the world. We grow in winter months only, January, February, March, when the other areas of production are really low.
Well, we've got another caller on the line. We've got Donna from Port Orange. Hi, Donna. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
Can you grow strawberries from seeds, or is it better to start them already in the flat?
She's asking whether we can start them from seed or whether or not we start them from the flat.
But
I think she means by bare root.
I know what you mean, but it's a great question because strawberries don't grow from seeds. This is what you're going to really surprise you. There's 200 seeds on every strawberry, and every seed is genetically different. You would grow a mismatch of plants. You don't know what you would produce. So what we do commercially is the plants are all grown in tissue cultures. They're cloned in laboratory environment and grown out at nursery level by runners. There's a mother and daughter plant. The mother plant produces a shoot, which then roots and makes a daughter plant, which is genetically identical. So all the reproduction is done vegetative, mother-daughter plant. And that's really the only way that these plants exist. Now, they grow in the nurseries all summer in Canada or North Carolina, drier climate, higher elevation, get them out of the hostile humidity of Florida. And they make runners all summer long. In the fall, we dig them up, transplant them down here with bare roots, into the soil, as you saw in the video earlier. And that really is how the plant really gets going, and we make sure everything is identical and predictable.
I see. We've got another caller on the line, Karen from Daytona. Hi, Karen. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Yes, hello. I was wondering if I would need to use pesticides, and if the pesticides are used on the strawberries. I mean, if I could grow them organic.
Okay, good question. How to grow strawberries organically?
Get out of Florida.
Oh, no, come on.
Really, we have so many pests and bacterial diseases and fungus in Florida that it is extremely difficult. And they're trying. They do it. It's probably best done in completely covered culture, in an environment that would either require a plastic hoop or a greenhouse situation. There's a little bit being experimented with soilless media in core, which is a coconut fiber. But we have a very hostile environment for organic here in Florida.
Right.
Not that we don't want to do it.
Yeah, it's going to be cost prohibitive in order to grow it organically.
It's extremely expensive. Your production is quite low, and the fruit is not really up to the quality level we would like it to be.
Plus, you know, the state of Florida, just like the rest of the country, is so regulated that, you know, everything we meet does meet our health standards, code standards. So we have the healthiest fruit in the nation.
Exactly.
We've got another caller on the line from Apopka. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question tonight?
Well, I'd like to know if there are any U-pick strawberry fields in the vicinity, you know, Orlando general area, 1 or 2 hours out, or perhaps there's a website that I can go to?
Well, she brings up a good question. Yes, you can. That's a good question. And what we recommend is you go to the internet and you type in U-pick, Florida, and from there, you'll get a hold of all kinds of U-pick farms, not only strawberries, but also berries, blueberries, blackberries, you name it. So there's a plethora there, and you can actually put the district that you're at, north, south, central Florida, or your zip code, or your city. So that's a great way to do it, or contact your local extension office, and they'll tell you one that's closest to you.
Okay. We also put on our website members of ours that are on that do you pick as they open, and we try and keep that posted and updated, but you'd have to come to Plant City. They're not in Apopka.
So, and also at your website.
www.flastrawberry.com.
And they'll have a full listing of them as well.
We try and list them as they open.
Yeah, that's wonderful.
They're opening, very soon.
Well, do you have any final thoughts on the strawberries?
Oh, we love everybody to eat all they can. It's, you know, it's just a fascinating crop. It's, you know, I'm involved with the science behind it, the breeding, the insect controls. Everything we do is just, the University of Florida is, I can't say enough about what they really do for our growers. In terms of scientific support, this is a very technical crop, and we absolutely love the support we get from the university.
And they support a lot of scholarships. But I also want to point out this little, why don't you tell the viewers what this is?
Well, as the pickers go through the field, they have a little cart that they rest their boxes on as they pick. And they pick into it. They would have open clamshells in the flat. And they would pick their fruit into that cart and roll it as they go until the box is full. And then they take the box into a truck, which immediately runs them to the coolers to get them into refrigeration. It's very important, particularly now with such a hot climate we have, to get this fruit cold quickly. As soon as it's harvested, they will pick early in the morning. We've even had pickers go out at 3 a.m. with big spotlights like road construction crews and pick at night when it was really hot days. Because the quicker you can chill it, the more shelf life that consumer will have.
Is it mostly ground travel or air travel? How do they mostly ship the
majority? Mostly ground. Refrigerated trucks up and down the East Coast is primary. We even have jammer on a truck. We did a truck wrap last year where we've got a big picture of the jammer on the side of the truck saying, "Eat Florida strawberries." So we have rolling advertising.
That's wonderful. Now, what is the annual yield of strawberries per year? How many flats do they pull out? Or what's the poundage for the statewide?
Wow. Well, there's probably 2,500 flats per acre and 20, 25,000 pounds an acre.
Wow, then that's quite a bit.
Easily.
That is quite a bit.
I think I understated that.
Yeah, you never know. Well, we want to encourage all teachers to see the site and get some educational
sure.
material there that's available. Also, there's some wonderful, delicious recipes on the floridastrawberry.com site.
On the website?
Yes, and also with the festivals and the events that are coming up. Now, where can homeowners buy some of these strawberry plants?
The plants? Well, I think a lot of the garden centers sell strawberry plants. They may not necessarily be the ones that the commercial growers buy, but they are all viable strawberries, and what they will do is they'll have the plant that will work in your yard. It may not be the same plant that a commercial guy would grow in Hillsborough County or Orlando.
And they'll actually see how hard it is truly to grow strawberries, what the commercial grower has to go through.
Farming's not easy. It's been a very challenging business, and it's really rewarding to get it.
It is. Well, that's the end of our program, and I'd like to thank my guest, Ted Campbell, for sharing his information about strawberries, and thank all of you for tuning in to today's program. If you'd like more information on strawberries, you can email me at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. Thank you for allowing me to be part of your gardening experiences. May you find your garden as a place of discovery and inspiration, with a little perspiration along the way. Thank you for watching Gardener's Hotline.